Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum, my viewers. My name is Professor Dr. Rizwan Jamil Qureshi, and I'm covering the continuation of my previous video in which I tried to cover project specs, but due to shortage of time, I cover only the part of that. So it's a part two of that video. Project specs is software project specifications, is also known as baseline document, or we also call it proposal. So academically, normally we call it proposal, but industry normally use the term project specs. In hardware terminology, we also use the term quotation. But what we cover in software project specs or baseline document, we have project introduction and we have feasibility assessments. The project introduction I already covered in detail in my previous videos, so you can check there. I will just touch the part of the feasibilities which I am not able to cover in my previous video. Feasibilities, there are many feasibilities. We have economic, we have technical, we have operational, we have schedule, we have social, and so on. But the most important are four: economic, technical, operational, and schedule. I was covering economic feasibility in my previous video, which is composed of estimating project benefits and estimating project cost. The project benefits, we have two types. We have tangible and we have intangible. I covered main tangible benefits in my previous video, that is time saving, cost saving, error reduction, opening new markets, sale opportunities, improvement management planning and control. These all are tangible benefits, and these are calculated in monetary values and cost, like dollar or rupees or real. So I cover in detail that how you can take time saving, cost saving, error reduction, how it will save the time, cost, effort and resources of the customer, and how it will improve the business processes to increase the business of the customer, increase sale, better market opportunities, and better planning and control will also bring into the benefits in terms of cost. And we have discussed intangible benefits: efficiency, performance, quality, employees' morale, company goodwill, customer satisfaction. These all are intangible, which cannot be directly estimated or measured in terms of monetary values. So this was my previous video about the project specs. Today I am covering how to estimate the cost of the project. So we have several techniques to estimate the cost. We have line of code, which is the one of the oldest techniques and proposed in 1970s and early 80s, we use that. And then we have function point technique. We have COCOMO 1, the constructive cost model 1, constructive cost model 2. We have new line of code technique, and we have agile budgeting. So these are the most well-known cost estimation techniques. I will touch them one by one. The line of code technique, in which we have the history or the past projects, and we have the data of the past projects, like for example project name or title, how much was the size of the previous project, then how much was the errors, and we have defects. There is a difference in errors and defects. Errors are the bugs which are reported at the software company side, and but defects are the bugs which are reported by customer, are the errors which are reported by the customer. To distinguish between them, we use the term errors and defects. So how many errors were there in the past projects, how many defects were there in the past projects, and then how much was the effort and the number of people. We have a relationship between effort and people as well. That if, for example, we have effort unit is person months, PM, person months. So how much is the effort in person months? For example, effort in person month is 40. how much is the people team size? Like 10. So 40 divided by 10, that means one person has to do the job of four persons in 1 month. Normally team sizes are small. We don't hire too much team sizes for the medium sized companies or small sized companies. So we have always more effort and less people. So how much was the effort in person months in the previous projects? How much was the team size, people? How much was the documentation? So these are the data which are available for the past projects and the language. Now, when we are going to predict or estimate cost, which is approximate cost, we consider the past projects, that the similar previous projects for the new project. Now, maybe the new project is in IDE environment, for example, integrated development environment. And the previous project was hard-coded language we use. We call hard-coded languages like Java, we have COBOL, we have Pascal, we have Fortran, we have C. So we don't have visual environment. So if we are not using visual tools in the previous projects, then for the new project, the cost will not be accurate. It will be inaccurate. And another thing, it depends on the expert, which is the project manager or the system analyst, which is dealing about the past project. So how he utilized the effort and his team to accomplish the project. So another problem with the new project and line of code method is that this matrix for the new project will be completed only once project is completed. So there's no benefit, much further. There's no benefit of that. Once the project is over, it may be helpful for the next project, future projects, but not for the current project. So most of the software companies, the majority, they rejected this technique. And then in 1979, function point technique was introduced. Function point technique used the current project detail, and it is depending on the number of functions of the project. So function point, number of functions in terms of points, how many functions are there. And we are at the planning level. We are doing all these exercises to complete project specs, to win project, because we are not sure we are going to win this project, because we have competitors. And customer may be send request, which is called system service request, to more than one company. Normally, this is the practice for 3-4 companies. And like Microsoft, Oracle, SAP, or any private company, like in Pakistan, we have NetSol, or we have system software, or in Saudi Arabia, we have STC, which is also a Hukuma-based company. So any company, private company, to have the competition. And then you are not sure that you are going to win this project or not, and you are at planning level, you have not written even a single line, how to calculate number of functions. To have this problem, the solution is proposed. The function point technique has a formula which is equal to UFC, unadjustable function count, multiplied by technical complexity factor. And then you have UFC multiplied by technical complexity factor. So UFC is depending on 5 parameters: number of inputs, external inputs, number of external outputs, number of external inquiries, number of external interfaces, and number of logical files. Logical files, we can have file-based system, and we can have a database, like tables are there. So we call them logical files. And then each of them, we have to write 3 values: optimistic, realistic, pessimistic. So O, R, P, the three values are there. The best case, the worst case, and the real case. And then we calculate EC, estimated count. That we have a formula which is like decision tree formula. We have like per chart formula. We have O plus 4 into R, optimistic, plus 4 into realistic, plus P, pessimistic. R divided by 6, whole divided by 6. The result will be divided by 6. So we have estimated count, we call it EC. Then the function point technique has to deal with the complexity. There was a problem in line of code that we are not dealing with the complexity of the current project. We don't have any column for complexity. Maybe previous project is not complex, a new project is complex. That was another problem in the line of code technique that was addressed in the function point technique to solve the problems of line of code method. Now, function point technique has introduced constants for number of inputs, number of outputs, number of inquiries, number of files, number of interfaces. And we have types of project. We divide the project in terms of types based on complexity. Complexity, normally we define level of difficulty to solve a problem. So we have simple or low complexity projects. We have average complexity projects, and we have high complexity project. Complexity in terms of human being, we say the level of difficulty. When you do anything first time, it is highly complex for you. For example, car driving, you do first time, it is highly complex. Especially if you are driving manual car. I remember my experience, personal experience, when I was first time learning, when I look at the front, I don't know where is my foot setting, pressing the gear or brake or race. I was not able to adjust them, and meanwhile car stopped. If I look down, then I cannot see in the front, on the front, and my instructor, I learned from a driving school, my instructor suddenly start shouting, "What are you doing? Look at the front. You will hit to someone. You will kill someone." So it was a great problem for me. So with the passage of time, I know how to adjust gear, brake, race, and the problem was fixed, and I was looking at the front, and automatically my foot setting was there. And then another example, for example, programming. I learned all programming languages, C, C++, Java, Visual Basic, ASP, PHP, Perl, ColdFusion, XML, HTML, by myself. Nobody taught me in the lecture or in the classroom. I took help from many of my colleagues. I'm greatly honored to them, and I am very thankful to them, extremely thankful to them to help me. So it was my own experience when I was learning most of the languages, and I found Java the toughest, and especially I learned Java using Notepad. I did not use any visual tool like JBuilder was there, and later on we have NetBeans. So I was using Notepad, and it was very hard because you have to remember the syntax of Java. And especially my first language was Fortran, and during my engineering in 1991-92, I did not take it seriously till I started my master's in 1999. And then my first language was Visual Basic, which I seriously learned from career point of view, from professional point of view. And Visual Basic, you know, it's IDE environment, integrated development environment. It's a visual tool, it's a framework. So it's very easy to do programming in Visual Basic 6, I learned. And then I moved to ASP to do my final project, degree project, master thesis, active server pages by Microsoft, which is using Visual VBScript. And it was also very easy for me, the client side and the server side. But once I moved to C and C++, it was tough for me at the beginning. But once I started Java, I feel like I'm burst. I will burst, and my mind will like I have brain hemorrhage or something. It was so much stress to learn Java, and especially Java has so many technologies. I learned applets, frame, swing, servlets, JSP, beans. So as I move in the advanced technologies of Java, it was headache. So it was so much difficult for me, from Visual environment to Notepad environment without any supporting library and the references. So it was very tough. So programming, when you use Notepad or you do using Java, it's hard for you, highly complex for you. But with the passage of time, like driving, now I already drove at mountain area. Let me give you an example of mountain area, because I used to drive in city and on normal highway. It was not so tough, but once I drove in mountain area, Jabal area, you know, when you are going up, it's not a big deal. But when you are coming down from the mountain area, it's like momentum of the car, gravity is there. And I used to press gear and second gear, third gear, brake, gear, brake, gear, brake. And at a certain time, after like 30 minutes of my drive, suddenly my brake fails because of it was heated up and it stopped working. And then luckily, I slowed down by having automatically the gear, the first gear, and there was not so sharp down turn, so I stopped at a certain point. Luckily I survived, but many people they couldn't survive because of the sharp turns, and they fell down from the mountain area because they don't have any experience to drive in that area. The experienced drivers know that how to drive in the mountain area. You don't need to press the brake frequently. You just press, you automatically drive by using the gear, the first gear, max the second gear. So the complexity with the passage of time, from high it becomes average, and from average it becomes so simple that even you receive a phone call or you are talking to someone, you don't know how you are driving, and you left your office. When you reach home, you surprise, oh, you pass the whole way without mentally you are involved in that, because you are discussing something with someone or you are talking to someone on some other topic. So it was by default, it was embedded in your mind. So complexity decreased from high to low. Same is the projects. Software company, when they do any project first time, it is highly complex for them. Let me take an example of NetSol company. NetSol company start developing the leasing software, Taxeed software, for BMW in 1990s. And it was highly complex for them. And there was so much pressure, because if this was the first big project, and was the company was giant, like big name BMW Germany, if they failed, the company will be closed, khali wali, and kafal lock will be there. So they need to open bakala or departmental store. So there was pressure, and they don't have any previous code, so they were starting from line one. They don't know how many bugs will come, how to fix them, what's the logic, what are the requirements, when the new requirements will come, how they will deal with them, and so on. So they were learning. And when you are learning anything first time, it is highly complex. Then luckily, they survive and they successfully deploy the project at BMW. And then BMW asked them to develop the same software for them, for BMW Germany to UK, then USA, then Australia. Meanwhile, Mercedes-Benz jumped and they asked the Netswell company to develop the software, leasing software for them as well. Now they have some previous code. And there are some new requirements from Mercedes-Benz, which is not the same as the BMW. So they have some previous code and they have to develop some new code. So the project transits from high complexity project to average project, complexity project, because they have some previous code, reusable code, and some new code they need to develop. And then Mercedes-Benz, Germany, UK, Australia, Taiwan, Korea, India, and so on, USA. So then Nissan company jumped, and then Nissan asked them to develop the same software, leasing software for them. Then Yamaha motorbike asked them. So now there are many clients, and in different countries they are operating, multinationally they are dealing. Germany, UK, USA, Australia, Taiwan, Korea, India, and Pakistan, of course, they have the base, head office is there. So the project moves from high complexity to simple complexity or low complexity. Now they have 70 plus versions of the same software from 1996. They deploy first time till 2020, the 24 years are there. So during these 24, they have 70 plus versions of the same software. And now project moves from high complexity to simple low complexity. When any new project comes, they just match which of the version is close to the previous project. Then they do little customization, and then they deploy. So that's the way we deal with the project, the complexity. So function point introduce complexity factor based on low complexity, simple complexity factor, the constants, average complexity factor and high complexity factor. So number of inputs, number of outputs, number of inquiries, number of files, number of interfaces all have low complexity, average complexity and high complexity. Now based on the nature of project, if it is low complexity, then we select the constants for low complexity. If the project falls under the average, we take the average complexity factor. If project falls under the high complexity, then we took only those complexity factor for high and rest we ignore. EC multiply by, for example, number of inputs. EC of number of inputs, O plus 4 into R plus P divided by 6 multiplied by the complexity factor. Then we do the same for outputs, then the same for inquiries, number of files, number of interfaces. So we have 5 values. After multiplying the complexity factor of EC with EC, there are 5 values. The summation of these 5 values is equal to UFC, sigma of these 5 values, summation. That is UFC. Then we have technical complexity factor. There is a formula by the function point technique. We have 0.65 plus 0.01. 0.65 plus 0.01 multiplied by sigma fi. Sigma fi is 14, summation of 14 questions. Is summation of 14 questions. We have to scale them between 0 to 5. There are 14 questions introduced, defined by function point. We have to scale each question. We have to answer like questioner or survey between 0 and 5. For example, I will discuss one or two questions with you to understand what are those questions. The detail you can see in my slides or in the book, Pressman book, the reference. References I'm using is Software Engineering by Roger S. Pressman and Software Engineering by Ian Somerville. And I'm using Modern System Analysis and Design by Jeffrey Hoffer. So these are the main core, and there are many supporting books I'm using. These are my academic references to teach to cover these topics or the cover this area of software engineering, the software project specs or the all related videos. So these are the main core references for software engineering courses. So for example, number of first question, is the new system is centralized or distributed? So you have to scale between 0 to 5. Does the new system require backup? How much frequently new system requires backup? Now, if it is banking system, you need daily backup, maybe twice a day or thrice a day. So you have to assign value between 4 or 5. If it is a tender system, you may assign a value between like 3 or 2. If it is like payroll system, then you need 4 or 5. So because you need backup, centralized or distributed, you can assign a value. So these are the some examples of questions, the submission of four. So each question you will scale a value between 0 and 5. The submission of these 14 question values equal sigma fi is the number of 14 submission of 14 questions. Then you have TCF, technical complexity factor, 0.65 plus 0.01 multiplied by sigma fi, you have TCF value. So for example, UFC value is 349 after submission of the 5 values, EC multiplied by technical complexity, multiplied by the complexity factor, low, average or high, is 349. And TCF, the sigma FI, maybe it's a 49, for example, or 50. So TCF 0.65 plus 0.01 multiplied by 49. So you have 1.15 or 1.17. TCF value is equal to 1. So function point is equal to UFC multiplied by TCF 349 multiplied by 1.15 or 1.17, for example. So you have a value. That is the function point. That means if it is like, for example, 382 something, so you have to develop 382 functions for the new project. That is the function point. But our job is not over. We are not done. We did not calculate the project cost. So every company has its average productivity. How many functions they develop in 1 month? So for example, the average productivity of the company is 7 function point per month. 7 new function point per month. 7 function point per month is the average productivity. And for example, company knows how much labor cost, how much cost they are spending to develop 7 new functions in 1 month. So you can calculate cost per function point. So cost per function point is equal to you have the average productivity and you have the average cost. So labor cost of the company. So for example, 4000 divided by 7. So you know this is the, like it is $571 or 571, for example, riyal. So like I will take $571. So $571 you are spending to develop 1 new function. Now you have to calculate project cost. So project cost is equal to cost per function point multiplied by function point of the new project. So like cost per function point is $571. So you are spending $571 to develop 1 new function. 571 multiplied by function point, which is like, for example, 382. So 382 multiplied by 571, so you have project cost in dollar or whatever the currency you are using. So that's the way to calculate the project cost by using function point technique. Then we have backfiring method. That backfiring method doesn't deal directly to calculate the cost, but it is extension of function point. Now there are some problems with the function point technique. For example, function point technique used the constant low, average and high, but optimistic, realistic, pessimistic are the variables. And it depends on, they are very subjective. It depends on the expertise of the project manager, how much accurately he can assign value for inputs, optimistic, realistic, pessimistic, for outputs, for inquiries, for files, and for interfaces. If these values are wrong, automatically your UFC will wrong and your function point will wrong. Same is the case of Sigma FI, number 14 questions. Your backup is there. How much accuracy is critical? That's another question. You have to assign between 1 to 5. If it is like safety critical project, you need high value, 5 or 4. If it is readiness system, you may assign value 2 or 3, because nothing is serious about the human life if readiness will be wrong. So you may assign the criticality between 2 or 3. So like this, all questions when you assign value between 0 and 5, the 14 question, they are also very subjective. Depends, the accuracy depends on the expertise of the project manager. So if your Sigma FI is wrong, TCF will be wrong. If TCF, technical complexity factor, is wrong, your function point will be wrong and the cost will be wrong. So if you are like, you have like the customer has 3 or 4 contractors like SAP, Microsoft, Oracle, and any private company like NetSol or System, then if cost is wrong and other competitors has accurate cost, then you will be straightforward rejected, because there will be cost difference between the competitors and you. So if it is too low, then again problem. If it is too high, then again problem. So your cost should be close to the competitor's cost. So that's the function point technique problem. But it provides us way to deal with the current project, and it provides a roadmap for the other researchers to introduce the new techniques to cover the rest of the parameters which were introduced in line of code method. So backfiling method will help us to calculate the size of software in terms of number of lines, source line of code. So source line of code in backfiring method, backfiring technique, they introduced every source line of code per function point for different programming languages like COBOL, C, C++, Visual Basic 6, C#, PHP, Ada, Pascal, Fortran, and so on. For example, we are using Java, and every source line of code per function point for Java is 63. That means on the average, you need to write 63 lines to develop one new function in Java. This is the average. Based on the past projects, the history of the past projects, the data from the previous project, the every source line of code per function point introduced based on the data of the past projects in different programming languages. So that is average is 63 source line of code per function point. That means you need to write 63 source new lines to develop one function using Java. The same is the case of Visual Basic and so on. You have, for example, 42 or 18 lines or 32 lines in different programming languages. There are different parameters available, average source line of. So for example, we are using Java. So whatever the function point we have, for example, we have 382 multiplied by 63. So the formula in backfiring method to calculate size in source line of code is equal to source line of code per function point, the constant introduced by using backfiring method, multiplied by function point of the new project, which is we have calculated 382. So 382 multiplied by 63. So you have size in source line of code. So that's the extension of function point. Then Barry Boehm, which is very well-known name and very respectable name and very authentic person. He has written many books, many articles, many contributions in the field of software engineering. Founders, one of the founders of software engineering. So Barry Boehm has also introduced spiral model. So another contribution is COCOMO 1 and COCOMO 2, Constructive Cost Model 1, Constructive Cost Model 2. So Constructive Cost Model 1 is for introduced for structured programming languages to calculate the project cost and the other parameters, like we have function point, how many functions are there, we have project cost, we have size in source line of code, but we don't know how much is the effort and the time and team size, which are very important to start any project. So Barry Boehm introduced his technique to calculate the effort, and it is also extension of function point. So it used the size which we calculated in backfiring method in kilo line of code. We have to divide size from source line of code to kilo line of code. So we have a formula to calculate the effort by using function point. Let me see, effort formula is equal to 2.4 multiplied by size in KLOC power 1.05. 2.4 multiplied by size in KLOC power 1.05. So whatever the size you have, the 382 multiplied by 63, so you have to divide it with 1000. It's in kilo line of code. When something in kilo line of code from size, so you have to divide by 1000. And from kilo to source line of code, you have to multiply with the 1000. So it's a mathematics, basic mathematics. So you have 2.4 multiplied by size in KLOC. So we divide the size in KLOC, divide by 1000, power 1.05, you have effort in person month. Effort could be in person year if we have done calculation years. Then time, how to calculate the time? 2.5 multiply by effort power 0.38. So you have whatever effort you calculated by using Barry Boehm formula, you put there power 0.38 multiplied by 2.5, you have the time in months. Then people, team size, effort divided by time, so you have number of persons. So how many persons are there? It could be 5, 6, 10, whatever the person. So you need 5 person or 6 person. So we have functions, we have cost, we have size, we have effort, we have time, we have team size. This is what we need. This is what we were taking from the line of code technique from the past project. Instead of the past project, we deal with the current project. So that's your COCOMO 1. COCOMO 2 is introduced for object-oriented technique, and we have object point, total number of objects. Like function point, we have OP, total number of objects in the new project, and then we have to calculate NOP. NOP being new object point. So in order to calculate how many new objects we develop, we have a formula: OP object point multiplied by 100 minus percentage reuse divided by 100, because it's for object-oriented technique. In order to calculate OP, instead of 5 parameters, Barry Boehm use, like function point has 5 parameters: input, output, inquiries, file, interfaces. COCOMO 2 has 3 parameters: number of screens, number of reports, and number of components. Number of screens, like function point, optimistic, realistic, pessimistic, and then we have EC O plus 4 into R plus P divided by 6, multiplied by complexity factors. Barry Boehm introduced its own complexity factors for screens, reports, and number of components, and then you multiply EC with the complexity factor, so you have 3 values. The summation of these 3 values is equal to OP object point, total number of objects in the new project. And then you calculate NOP, OP multiplied by 100 minus percentage reuse divided by 100, so you have NOP. And then you know the average productivity of the company, like $4,000 or $6,000 per month. And you know, you don't know your the product, you know the productivity, you know the cost, But Barry Boehm introduced its own metrics for the productivity. Instead, company will calculate its average productivity from the past projects. Kokomo 1 was introduced in 1981. It is also called Kokomo 1. Whereas Kokomo 2 was introduced in 1995-96. So Barry Boehm took a long period to introduce object-oriented technique to calculate cost. So he used data of many projects, and then he introduced his own formula for the average productivity. So his formula to calculate average productivity, he introduced constant, that you just need to see the table and you pick your productivity depending upon two parameters. How much developer are experienced in the company? How much experienced developers are there? Experienced team is there, especially the programmers. And how much company environment is mature, maturity of the company, how long they are operating, like 1 year, 2 year, 5 year, 10 year. So based on that, you can pick productivity. If the company is new, fresh, the productivity will be very low. For example, 4 NOP per month. If company is like has some experience, their productivity will be 7 NOP per month. If company is operating for 7-8 years and more than that, like 10 years, we can have high product, highly experienced programmers, and their environment is quite mature because they are operating from like 10 years plus. Like their productivity will be 25 NOP per month. If company developers' experience is very high, so very low to very high, like 20 or more than that, like system company in Pakistan, they were started in 1980s, so it's 20, almost 40 years. Nutsoul from 1990s till 20, Microsoft, IBM, Google, Facebook, they are quite mature companies. They have highly experienced programmers are there, and their environment is highly mature, multinational companies. So their productivity will be 50 NOP per month. So that's the parameters. Normally, the software companies, small to medium size, they have nominal productivity that is 13 NOP per month. So you know your productivity from the table, not you calculate by yourself. So you have to pick the table from the table. But you know your labor cost. Labor cost, how much you are spending the cost in 1 month, salaries, bill, rent, and so on. So like $8,000 per month. 8,000 divided by 13, you have cost per NOP. So project cost is equal to cost per NOP multiplied by NOP of the new project. So you have project cost. And then you can calculate time, effort first. Effort NOP divided by productivity. And then you have time, 3 multiplied by effort, power 0.33 plus 0.2 multiplied by B. B is an exponent, which is depending on several parameters, minus 1.01. So you have this formula, you put the value of effort and the B constant, there is a range for that. It depends on its normal range is 1.1 to 1.24, depending on novelty of the project, how much the development is flexible, deadlines, risk management, and team cohesion, how my team is centralized or distributed, and the process maturity. So in based on these parameters, one is the novelty, two is the flexibility, development environment, in terms of deadlines, risk management, team cohesion, how much team is strongly gel, coordinated, communicated, coordination, collaboration, and how much their processes are mature. So 5 parameters are there to calculate the B. So you put the B value, for example, the case studies I taught in my lectures, 1.17. So whatever the value of effort you have, for example, in my example I taught in my lecture, the effort is, for example, 5% month. So you have the value of time you have, you put there in the formula, 3 multiplied by 5 power 0.33 plus 0.2 multiplied by 1.17, the B value minus 1.01. So time is approximately 5.3 months something. And number of people, effort over time, so you have person. How many teams, how much is the team size? So in this way, you can calculate all the parameters by using Kokomo 2. So then you have new line of code technique. In the new line of code technique, it depends on use cases. But that's very complex calculation. So in order to avoid that, just summarize that how you calculate the new line of code technique. You have a formula, you know the productivity, average productivity, how many new lines per month you are calculating. So you have productivity and you know your cost. Or you have backfiring method, you can calculate directly the size from there. And how much cost you are spending. So labor cost divided by productivity, you have cost per line of code, like cost per function point or cost per NOP. And then project cost, you have LOC multiplied by cost per LOC. So you have line of code technique, new line of code technique to calculate the cost based on number of lines. And then we have agile budgeting. Agile budgeting, we have stories in agile requirements are called stories. So we have stories and we have story point. Story point is the amount of time to complete a requirement. So you have number story points, and then based on you have the cases that how many releases are there. How many, like in Scrum, we have sprint, which releases are called sprint. So you have how many releases are there? You have 6 releases, 7 releases, 8 releases, or 2, 4, 6, 2. So we have to take 3 cases, best case, average case, and the worst case. And then you calculate EC, like O plus 4 into R plus P. So the worst case plus the average case. 4 in multiply by average case plus best case divided by 6. So you have the EC. So EC is there. How many releases are there? And you know how much cost you are spending on one release, average cost per story. So whatever the cost per story you are calculating, so how many releases are there? 6 multiply by the cost to cover that release. So in this way you have the project cost for the agile. That's about the all well-known techniques for the cost estimations. This is your economic feasibility, and then you have a technical feasibility that I will cover inshallah in the part 3 of my video inshallah in the next lecture, in the next video. Thank you very much, and Jazakallah khair. May Allah bless you. Assalamu alaikum.